nice words. He was looking, I was thinking about it just now. I haven't thought about this until I just sit down this morning. One year ago, this didn't exist. Really, not even in my mind. I mean, it's amazing. I mean, this is a dream become true, like in a super short time span. So thank you, Isaac, and thank you all of you, because I know that for many of you, it's been an amazing effort to come here. I remember helping out Jay with his passport last year, because it was the first time he was traveling internationally. And for all of you leaving your families and whatnot and traveling from the communities where you are living, it's not an easy thing to come all the way to Nairobi to share with us all your knowledge. So thank you very much, everyone in the room. So I started looking at community networks a long ago. Actually, it's also a pleasure for me that Roger from GiffyNet is here to present a bit later what Giphy is doing. Giphy is one of the precursors of community networks, one of the largest ones in the world, and it's set in Spain, where I come from. And for me, it was an eye-opener. I was working for another organization that was providing connectivity in Latin America between healthcare centers and hospitals, but that connectivity was very much top-down. It wasn't the bottom-up approach of giving the people the opportunity of use the technology for meeting their own communication needs. And later on, through some coincidences, I got the opportunity to go to South Africa and put that knowledge that I had about open source, about unlicensed spectrum, about Wi-Fi, about all those type of things in the hands of a particular community, Mankosi, where I've been working with for the last 6 years. You will hear from Jay and Luando later on Senseleni Networks. I won't extend much on it. So we were working on Senseleni for quite some time, 3, 4, 5 years, and we were getting quite a lot of traction, more nationally, internationally, and in the community, actually. And we were thinking, why internationally we get so much attention, but yet there are not that many other communities in South Africa that replicate what we are doing? What are the issues that are other community networks in Africa facing? What are other communities in Africa doing? So in that sense, I'm feeling that we were a bit stuck. I started this research on trying to map community networks in Africa. With all my surprise, when the report was, when my own map was done, that was for the Dynamic Coalition on Community Connectivity Report of the IGF, I received an email from Chuki or from Jane, I don't remember anymore. And they said, we were looking to do a similar map, but you've done it, and we have some budget. What would you like to, what would you recommend us to do next? And then I said, well, why don't we bring us to, we bring some of them together, and we learn a bit more about what community networks are doing in Africa, because at the end, what I did was just, with my colleague Michael Graf, going through the information that some of you have on your websites. So with the help of ISOC, we managed to organize last year, through during Africai, the first summit of community network, where most of us met for the first time, and this movement started. I will talk a bit more about that. So anyway, community networks is not, is, or let's say, many people is starting to look at the role that ICT, at recognizing and acknowledging the role of ICTs that has for development in general. As such, the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals have included the very important role that ICTs have to play on development, on the broader development goals that are to achieve and to make this world a better or a more equitable place. However, the gap is growing. There is more in between those that can access, more speeds, more devices, more everything, cheaper access, faster rates, and those that are left behind. So there is a lot of initiatives at the moment from the IG, from the Internet Governance Forum, that is a UN process, through any other, and many other initiatives that are looking at how to connect the next billion. At the moment, there are about 7 billion people in the planet. 4 of them don't have internet connection or cannot afford it. In this context, many people are looking, and there is a growing evidence about community networks as an alternative. However, there wasn't any evidence of community networks in Africa. If you look at people pointing at community networks, they will tell you about Giphy, they will tell you about Altermundi, they will tell you about Rizomatica, they will tell you about Nepal Wireless, about Osama Mansar, but they, no one would point out anyone in Africa. No matter the amazing job that for more than 10 years people like John or Fred have been doing, and some others more recently. So I started to gather this evidence, and well, through a methodology, I started looking at gathering information, as I said, from the, not only from the internet, but also by contacting people that I knew had been involved with rural communications in Africa. I interviewed or sent an email to Mike and to many other people, up to 60 people, and I complemented that with Google, with Michael Crabb, he helped quite a lot, with Google searches in French and in English, and we came out with a map of community networks that I will just present. Also, to build a report that we are launching today, to those experts that I was interviewing, I asked them what were the barriers that they thought were preventing more community networks to actually happen and appear in the continent. There will be a section there is a section of the report that actually goes through these barriers that were identified by the experts. And then the main block of the report is about understanding the community networks in Africa. This is based on the first summit on community networks last year, where 10 of the 10 community networks from 8 countries came and presented their job, and we had the opportunity to, through their presentation and through some other panels, to get some information. We had also, Michuki and I sat with them and had more than 8 hours of in-depth interviews with each of them to understand a bit more the context where they take place and some of the other information that I will be presenting. There was a follow-up panel in Africa where people like Anna, like Fred again, Joseph, and some other people I don't remember now, were part of that panel, where we continued developing and delving a bit deeper on this understanding of what community networks are, and what is the way forward, and where are they coming from. And some other opportunities that ISOC offered me to go to the Global IGF in Mexico, to another meeting of the Global Alliance for Internet for All in Cambridge last year, where I had more discussions with more community networks experts, where I get to know a bit more and frame a bit more the community networks movement in Africa within a bigger and a more global community networks movement, I would say. And the report as well has greatly improved by the feedback that I've received from a lot of ISOC members that have gone through initial drafts of the report. David has commented, Jane has commented. I sent the report to Mike, he also commented. So it's a collab. Also, the report was sent back to most of you that provided input on the first summit to actually make it a common effort and actually representing the views of everyone that was there. So, what is the map? How does the map look like? Well, the map looks like this. There is only one community network in the whole north of Africa, and is no longer active. In Tunisia, 60% of the networks that we identified were in South Africa. Maybe because we both are based in South Africa, we know some of the people that are working there, but there might be other factors as well related to the economy, the internet infrastructure, the ICT industry, and some other factors that will need to be understood. And they are 37 initiatives in 12 countries. We'll go a bit more into detail into this, but this is more about the understanding of those 10 community networks that I had the chance to interview with Michuki last year. People that are actually the ones that, I don't know, it's kind of interesting that I'm telling you this when all the information comes from you, so it's a bit awkward because I only learn from you, so I don't really know what I'm getting. But what I must say is that you did a very good job at making ISOC believe that the community networks in a way is the future, because this is happening because of the amazing job that you did last year on showcasing what are you doing for your communities and how impressive is the future for community networks in Africa. We wouldn't be here if it wasn't because of your amazing work. So I'm gonna go now through some of the points or some of the sections in the report. Some of them, I will skip them because maybe there's not going to be enough time. But in the first section of the report, I look at the factors behind community networks and some of the reasons were why people are starting community networks. Well, because in some places of Africa, there is no access. In many places of Africa, there is no access. And in many other places, there is access, but it's unaffordable. And community networks actually provide a way by pooling resources, by aggregating demand, on bringing the cost down. But also because of self-determination in terms of setting up the prices, in terms of setting up the services and the content that is relevant for the people, and in terms of having control over the infrastructure. And all those three together bring a lot of value to the local economy. We will have a presentation tomorrow from John bringing all these concepts together. But also, some of the factors behind are who are the people starting them. There are some informed community members, so the community network comes from within, like Josephine and Patrick from Tunapanda, Tato, Pacific from Esbukabu. It's people that have gone through the internet, have found out about community networks, and have figured out their ways to actually make it happen in their communities. In other places, like in the case of Sensalen, it's more external people who approach the communities and provide them with the knowledge and the skills to actually accompany them with the process. But in both cases, the local people that receive these skills from external people, and in the case of internal community members, everything, something that is strongly there is the vision. The vision that the network plays in the development of the community. They have a very clear vision of what the community want to be and what the network, what the role the network will play on it. Also about the location and the funding, the community networks in Africa are everywhere, pretty much as in the world. You can find community networks in Bukavu that has 1 million inhabitants, and you can have community networks in Senseleni, which is one of the most rural areas in South Africa. Sorry, Makosi. Also about the funding. The funding is related, we will analyze this later, but most of them receive some sort of seed capital to start the infrastructure. But that infrastructure didn't come alone, didn't come in a sense of becoming rich or in a sense of, I don't know how to say, the most important thing, and that was shared very strongly, was the vision that I was mentioning before about making your community a better place. Not much about making money, but about making the place where they live a place that they will continue wanting to live in the future. But they also live, community is a very interesting place, a very interesting concept. Now here we are at the AIS and we are gonna hear a lot about the technical community. The technical community is a community of practice. It's a group of people that live everywhere in the world that get together to do things. Whereas in the community networks that were in Nairobi last year, it's about the people you live with. It has a more spatially specific meaning. It's your neighbors, it's your family, it's the people that live around you. But by sharing that space respecting the norms around sharing that space is key for survival. There are some interesting quotes from John in the report there about how important it is to respect your neighbors and to respect the people that you have around you to actually survive in such a difficult environment like rural Africa in many cases. But at the same time, this community is the bigger asset. Probably we are gonna hear, I don't know, from Giphy or from some other community networks around the world, they need to build community. The technology is there, but they are good with the technology, but they need to build the community. In Africa, the community is there, and we only need to build the network, which is potentially easier, because as Jane was saying, what we need for community networks is the people, and the people and the bound within the people is already somehow there. I say somehow, because that's the hardest part. Those communities, there is also a lot of suspicion, a lot of criticism, a lot of scrutiny for those that are trying to stand out and to do something for them. As there is a... there is a lot of historical... how can I say? Historical process of the governments, of the community themselves, trying to keep the status quo and the things as they are. Anyone who stands out is gonna struggle, I would say, and all of you that are trying to do something as a community network need to be stronger. And I think this meeting actually creates these bounds with other people around the continent that are doing the same to see that you are not alone. So to keep that social cohesion, those of you that have made it happen, there are some measures that you actually went through. Some of them that you mentioned were around planting a good seed, about following a local protocol, about going to the tribal authority first, to the traditional authorities, and ask for permission to go to work there, to point you to the right people in the community that you could work with. It's also about clarity on the contributions and the expectations from the community if it's a partnership in between external and internal people. It's about sharing responsibilities. This is impossible to be a one-man show. It needs to be a community effort. And sharing those responsibilities and trusting others that you might not have trusted before is something that most of you have gone through. Some of the other things that you pointed out is about being transparent and accountable. And as Dr. Ni was saying, it's about being open, about sharing again. The availability of the books, the collective authorization for payments, there is no trying to make money out of it, there is trying to improve the community. And most of you are already putting this into place to make this fit in the community and getting that trust in the community so it involves as many people as possible without creating more conflicts. It's also about being consistent with initial words, with the initial goals. There is something Jay keeps on telling me that is about keeping your word. We say we were gonna do this, we keep on saying we are gonna do this, we are doing this. If you start saying this and all of a sudden you do something else, there is a lot of mistrust that are gonna appear. And I think there is a very interesting quote in the report from Michuki in that sense about that. And there is also the relation with the powerhouses in the communities. And it was through Fred and through other people that we identified three powerhouses: the traditional authorities, the churches, and the government. Actually, you can be in discussion with one of them, but if two of them, you are at odds with them, the project is gonna struggle. I would recommend you to talk to Fred if you want to know how to live in the line of these conflicts, because sometimes it's tricky, especially when you grow and you do things that others were supposed to be doing. So making that balance is something very important. But it's also about social inclusion and participation. And for participation analogies, bringing down the complexity of the technology to the language that people in the communities can understand. It's about training vulnerable groups. We were talking about the West Wall and the cities leaving the rural areas behind, but it's also within rural areas. There are people that are left behind because they are vulnerable. And here I would like to emphasize, and you can look around you, about women participation, and women dynamic and gender dynamics within the community networks. Women are not that much present. There were some examples that Fanswam is doing about promoting and positive discriminating with girls and women to actually participate in the training. Anna can tell you about how in Connecting in Anna, she was actually the trainer to be a role model for other girls in Enana, so they could see that girls could also engage in technology. There is, in Senseleni, they are trying to create spaces for the participation of women and also to recognize part of the work that they do that happen inside the households and that sometimes is not acknowledged publicly but is key for the running of the community network. On the technical aspects and on the service offered, on the infrastructure side, there were some commonalities. And some of them about the public facilities. People don't have access to devices, so there is a lot of push for internet cafes and kiosks. If you talk to most of you, most of that access happens in public spaces where people share devices. Either they share devices or they share the access hotspot, like in SOAR, is share access with user devices. Because still, the economies of these places don't allow for a connectivity per household as in other places, but at least you are coming up with ways to actually make access available to your own communities. It's about the use of Wi-Fi. We can go into the detail into this, but Wi-Fi is the main technology used for the access and for the backbone. And it's also about the lack of electricity, either because there is no electricity or because it's unreliable. Most of you were struggling, and we have a session particularly on solar power because of this. It's also about the internet and the intranet. Some of you have the luck that have some sort of affordable internet in the communities where you are working with. Some of others of you have to bring the internet to the community through a backhaul. Like for instance, Bosco Uganda has more than 14 ISAs. We just built one in Seseleni. Sowa has one. I think Pamoya also has a tower that connects to the island. But in some other cases, there is no internet access, like in Bukavu, because it's too expensive. We will go into the barriers. In Bukavu last year, a 1 Mbps connection was $1,000. We cannot be thinking about providing affordable access with those prices. So some of you are providing internet access, but some of you are also providing a lot of intranet services. You know, like Pamoya is creating this screen that you have there with local news. There is a lot of educational content that many from, I don't know, I remember now, Mes Bukavu, Tunapanda, that you have a site that can be accessed in the intranet. You don't need internet to actually access a lot of materials that can actually be many, very meaningful for the people in the community. We are at Senzeleni starting to play with voice over IP. Also Pamoya, I believe that is also starting to look at ways of providing Bosco Uganda working with voice over IP technologies, not just internet, but voice. And e-government, I think it was Connecting Enana that had a very strong edge on putting e-government files into the community network that could be downloaded. But it's not telecommunications per se. There is a huge emphasis on training, again, on including everyone, on sharing the benefits of the internet with as many people as possible in the communities. There is training, and you can talk to any of them about computer literacy, hardware maintenance, web development, human rights, cybersecurity, you name them. It's also about, and that's probably the most important part, it's about the non-IT related services. Some of the organizations here were moved from community development to include ICT services as part of their portfolio, and some others are moving from the ICT services to the revenue that they generate to provide some community development services in their communities. But again, the community development is a core component of the work that these organizations are doing. So how do they make themselves sustainable? As I said, they receive some seed funding from IDRC, from the OTI, from ISO Beyond Demand, from different funders. But they also have come out with some other mechanisms that are very interesting, like crowdfunding, in the case of Tunapanda, donations like Bosco, matching funds. I find this one very interesting that I believe Matcha Works is doing, that the community puts some part of the money and then Matcha finds the way of putting the other part of the money. And I think it was Matcha as well that managed to get access to Universal Service Access funds. Those funds from the government that should be used for exactly this and are used for you know what, I don't know exactly. Other ways are the local economy. I think this is, again, very important about that community development, about that component that I believe John will present tomorrow, about how the different services that are being provided reinforce each other to either make the ICT service provision sustainable or the other way around. It's a more economy, local ecosystem, local economy ecosystem than anything else. It's not only about the technology. It's also about in-kind contributions, about sharing. Sharing time for maintenance and decision making, sharing access to the roofs, to the walls, to the spaces inside the houses, or even to build the buildings themselves. As I think Bosco, the community organizations they work with, one of the things that they provide in kind is they build the internet house themselves, right? And tools, meals, you name them, in-kind contributions are key and are part of the sharing economy of rural and marginalized communities. But it's also about affordable access, as we were saying. Community networks are able to provide affordable access, are able to provide affordable voice services, are able to provide cheaper voice services, cheaper internet access. So actually it makes sense for people to use those services. But it's also about local knowledge and local value, and in understanding what your local community is willing to pay for. And that's only you who know that. No one else is going to tell you. But it's also about other non-monetary incentives. Like for instance, in Senseleni, they allow the people that are hosting the houses, the equipment, to have access to the solar power electricity to charge their phone for free or to have some LED lights in their houses. So it's finding ways of matching the local value with what the network can provide to the organization can provide to reduce costs. Three of the networks that we studied managed to scale, to reach other communities beyond the community where they started. Fanswan, they have a very interesting case where they have a mobile internet center that it goes from church to church in neighboring communities. Macha, they managed to replicate in five provinces? Five? Bosco Uganda last year, probably we'll hear now from their updates, they are in 32, they have 32 internet centers. So how do they do it? Unlike other cases, they do a more push approach. They are the ones going to the other communities, presenting them what are the benefits, what are the commitments that they need to do to actually be part of or be able to provide themselves with connectivity. In the case of Macha, again, the role of the tribal authority was very important because the role of Chief Chikata that was with us last year was key to open doors in other chiefdoms. The role and the power on having the tribal authorities on our side cannot be and it's also, there are two things here in between Macha and Bosco, for instance. From training in situ, as Bosco does, he goes to the community and train them in the community, train the new community where the new internet center is gonna be, that's where they receive training. In the case of Macha, it's different. In the case of Macha, they bring the people to Macha. So they are immersed and they know and they learn from what the people from Macha has been doing for 3, 6 months, whatever it takes. Because at the end, what they want, both Macha and Bosco, is that these people that they are training are able to independently operate the new centers that are created. I think for some of the networks here that are planning to scale, these are very interesting lessons to learn, and I encourage you to talk to those that have managed to make it happen, to learn from them. The way forward here is about the way forward that was shared by those 10 representatives that were with us last year. It was about creating, this is another question, because here I had a picture of yesterday's training. Because some of the things that you pointed out in November as the way forward are happening. It's about training, it's about peer exchange. We're going on Saturday and Sunday to Kibera, to Tunapanda. It's about learning and learning from each other and sharing. And this is happening already. It was also about having access to a repository of knowledge that I believe ISOC is creating. It's about creating a school of community networks where I think the last 3 days was a bit of a trial and getting a sense of how we can engage on training and receiving and giving training. So yes, it's amazing. There are community networks in Africa. They are doing an amazing job. But there are 37. How big is Africa? How many communities there are? Only in South Africa, that is where I have the numbers, there are like 7,200. 37 in the whole continent. What's happening? If it's so amazing, why people, what are we doing? Why people are not doing it? Maybe it's not that great, maybe the concept that So I needed to understand the barriers, and I think we are still understanding, all of us, the barriers. All of them came from the experts, and I just synthesized them, and I put them in 4 blocks, social, economic, technical, and legal. On the social barriers is the lack of awareness. The lack of awareness of the benefits of the internet itself, which is much with the lack of relevant content in languages that people can read and write and visualize and understand, because most of the content, as Fred was pointing last year, 90% of the content in the internet comes from the West, comes from the North, doesn't talk to the realities of the African people. But it's also about the lack of awareness of the possibility. I think it was Josephine or Patrick, I don't remember, mentioning that most communities wait for the government, for the operators, for things to happen. They don't have the drive to move forward. So let's try to figure out ways of how can we reduce that barrier, how we can encourage other communities to actually happen and making by themselves, like from awareness to action. What are the constraints that once people know that this is possible, is preventing them to actually do it by themselves? So it's about the historical process, and today is Africa Day, and I think read and think about what that means. Until 1957, this continent was a completely different story that I prefer not to talk about. That has created, and the governments afterward, sadly, has perpetuated a mindset of just wait there, or we will provide. We need to work and try to change that mindset in a way. And it's also about coming up with clear ways of showing the incentives and the benefits that the communities that you share with your neighboring communities, the benefits that has had for you and for your communities to actually go through this process. But it's also to be aware, especially on the partnership, of the gatekeeping situations. When you get trapped with a partner that might be wanting to take advantage of the community, or the other way around, or the community take advantage of the partner. So we need to level that play field and to understand and to share again, and to be here open. As I really like the opening speech by Professor Neil that on that sense. But there are economic barriers as well. In most of your communities, and again, you know that from a fact, people have to choose in between communicating and eating. So if people have to choose in between communicating and eating, how they are gonna pay for their own communication devices, for their network infrastructure? If that's the case and they are gonna make that step, we need to have a lot of evidence to back that argument. Else we need to come up with other seed funding mechanisms, matching funds, loans, whatever. Because the context of the African networks, of the African reality, also influence the cost of the community networks themselves. As I was saying, there is no electricity, or the electricity is very bad. That increases immensely the cost of the infrastructure, because you need to solar power those devices. It's about the local markets. I don't know by a fact, but I remember, I think it was Patrick last year, he had to buy a Raspberry Pi here in Nairobi, because there is no Raspberry Pis in DRC. Our experiences in UNTATA is that there is absolutely nothing. I mean, sometimes we struggle to buy to find nuts that fit the molds that we need to use. So local markets increase the cost, because you need to ship pretty much everything, both nationally and internationally. And then you have the import taxes, that it was a very big topic on the meeting last year, and that has been highlighted all over by many other sources, like the Alliance for Affordable Internet. But also affects the OPEX. The cost of the backhaul on site, as I was saying in the case of Bukavu, is very expensive. So if you have to go to a cheaper backhaul, building those towers has an immense cost. But it's also about the services. You don't have as many users as you may have in the towns, because they don't have user devices that can communicate with your technology. That's why the big operators that are making tons of money are center of people that have these devices. But it's also about the stipends. We need to come up with mechanisms to remunerate the people that are putting some time here. It's not about making money, it's about paying a fair salary for those that are committing their work to this at the time. There are some technical barriers as well, and we went through the training yesterday, and you will agree with me that there are some technical barriers in the sense of understanding the technology, understanding the ecosystem, understanding the infrastructure that could be covered by training eventually. But that brings into what John was saying last year as this continuous cycle of training and retraining, because people with those competencies, they go to other places to get a better employment. But it's also about the technologies. I was saying that we were using Wi-Fi, because that's the only thing that we can use. It's the only unlicensed band that is available in most countries in Africa. This is a picture of Enana, actually, where I was working with connecting Enana a couple of years ago. It's not very clear, but the house that we were trying to connect is just there behind all those trees. As you probably learned during the training, Wi-Fi doesn't go over trees, because they have a lot of water, the frequencies of Wi-Fi is absorbed by the water, there is no way of making a link there, there is no way of going up the trees and provide line of sight. And those technologies that allow us to go through non-licensed, through that allow non-line of sight communication, they are assigned nationally, and I'll go into that later. But there is also devices not working well. John was working on trying to identify fake Ethernet cables in the Nigerian market. There is also a lot of issues with heat and with dust that make the technologies last less in the African context. But there are also regulatory barriers. As I think, well, Professor Nee was saying as well, that there are some laws that can actually prevent things from happening. And I think the case of community networks is very obvious. The regulatory framework has been created for big operators. It's not catering for small operators and for community networks. So there is a need to raise awareness with the operators that this is a valid model. And there is a need as well to make them understand that, or to show with them, or to share with them that there are other ways that are not private-driven and market-driven to provide communications to the people, to deliver those e-government services that they have created already and that are not reaching the people that should be receiving those services. So some people mentioned this thing called regulatory capture that we can talk in private about if you want. There are some more particular barriers that I they mentioned about the small part of the spectrum. This is Wi-Fi that is available on a licensed spectrum compared to the big parts of the spectrum like GSM, TV wide spaces, or TV spectrum that is there, assigned nationally, and empty, totally empty in most of the rural areas where you guys are working. There is need to work on try to come out with strategies to claim our governments to allow the communities to operate these bands. There is lack of access to, well, there is lack in itself to open access backbones that could reduce the price of the backbone. High import duties, regulatory fees, inefficient use of universal service and access funds, etc. But it's also on your side, and it became very clear yesterday. You don't have a clue of the regulatory framework. And that doesn't make you a very good speaker with the regulators. If you want things to happen in your favor, you need to learn the language. You need to adapt to the context. You need to prove that you are showing some sort of respect. Doing things pirate, doing things without knowing, saying, no, I didn't know, I don't think it's going to take us that far. We need to commit to understand a bit more what is the environment where we are trying to operate. So that, to wrap up a bit of what we learned, there were some considerations for developing this context. What we learned from the barriers, how to move from here. And the first thing that came very strongly was that, unlike in other places, in Africa, a community network is not simply telecommunications infrastructure deployed and operated by citizens to meet their own communication needs. It is a tool to improve what a community is already doing in terms of their growth and development by contributing to a local ecosystem that enhances the daily lives of those staying in the community. So it's not the telecommunication infrastructure per se, it's about what the community wants to do with the infrastructure. I do believe, and the last year has shown me, and I think this meeting in itself is a proof of it, that this is only the beginning, that we are only going to grow from here. You know, we are starting to build tools that reduce the cost and the complexity to do this. We are starting to get together and share experiences and understand better the regulatory framework and talk about this. And many more people want to know about this. This is going to grow, and it's inevitable. And you are going to be key actors of this. It also allows us to learn about what are the local stakeholders with whom we need to build strategic partnerships. I've talked extensively about the traditional authorities. In South Africa, we don't have that much work with the churches, but you can talk to John or to Bosco Ganda or some other people that are working intensely with the churches and the role that they can play in facilitating most of these things. With the government, not only on allowing other type of regulation, but more recognition. Many people are not going to move a finger if they think that the government is against what you are doing. It's about using the dissemination channels, their public broadcasting entities, about putting in the vocational training that community networks is possible. It's about the local media houses, like Mes Bukavu started from Radio Mandeleo, from a group of journalists that wanted to create a different channel of communication in the breadth of the internet shutdowns in Congo. So the local media houses have a lot to learn from the community networks, as well as a lot to give in terms of dissemination and in terms of talking about what community networks are possible. So this is definitely another message. I don't know what I did with my computer anyway, because here there was a picture of all of you yesterday. Because something that is very important, as I was saying, is that this is only going to happen through you. Me spending 6 years in Mancos is not going to happen again. This is going to happen because other people are going to look at you in your eyes, are going to see themselves reflected, and are going to say, I want to be like you. And they are going to do it. And you are on the forefront of this. And it's great that you are here to gain more confidence, to gain more knowledge, and to push this forward. And I think this is key. This is key because you know the context, you know the local context, you know the local codes, you know the local understanding. As again, this is only going to happen from the communities and to the communities. It's not more about external people. So that's very important. But it's also very important because as it is very representative that you look around in this network, in this building, it was very representative, the picture on how underrepresented women are. And that's something also that we need to give a bit of a thought on how to promote more participation of women on the community networks movement. It's also about synthesizing and systematizing the gathering of evidence of what you are doing, so we are able to engage and convince other particular stakeholders, like government, businesses, donors, other researchers that could provide more evidence, and other communities. Maybe communities are not doing this because they don't know that value. We need to document that, we need to share that, we need to be able to create a language and a narrative to be able to communicate that with other people. And for that, I thought about creating a community networks observatory where all that knowledge and all that evidence can be aggregated and can be accessible for people to know about this. What about funding and sustainability? Well, as I was saying, the external seed capital is important, and the local seed capital might be difficult at this moment, provided the very low income that exists in most of these places. It still might be possible if enough evidence is shown of the benefit of the people to actually put their own money to create their own networks. But for now, the pool approach that, for instance, Altermundi or Somatica is doing, where the community get together, gather the funds, and they go to Altermundi or to Rizomatic, and they say, here is the money for the network, now teach us, you know, and show us how to do it. That might not be the case in Africa in the short term, but it may happen. It may happen if we manage to prove that we are able to create sustainable businesses that are able to make some sort of money to be able to repay the loans or the matching funds that we can create through some donor mechanisms. But it's also about, and that you requested, and for now, for that we have a session tomorrow, on receiving more business skills and more marketing training, on knowing how to maximize those funds that you receive. And it's also about continue developing capacity. I finished, or someone was joining, I just like 2 minutes, I think I'm going to be done. And it's about developing capacities through some of the people that are here, through AIS experts in technology and regulation, through a community network volunteers, is through the continuous engagement with universities. Most of the community networks last year have some way or another a link to a university. It's about creating travel and exchange scholarships so people can learn from each other. And it's about creating that school of community networks that you proposed last year and that was also discussed at the IGF in Mexico. And it's about creating videos from Africans for Africans, where again people can see themselves reflected to create this by themselves in video format, in voice format, so it touches the oral culture of the African continent. And again, it's around policy and regulatory engagements that we can talk as much as we want about them. It's about finding easier ways of fitting the community networks in the regulatory framework. It's about accessing and advocacy for more spectrum for community network. Again, GSM and TV spectrum is allocated nationally and rarely used in rural and remote areas. So we need to advocate our own governments to actually release those funds for the community to operate them, as in other countries in the world is happening. And it's also about open access and fairly priced backbone that would allow the reduction of the prices. So the report is full of recommendations. There are 2 pages to yourselves, to continue doing what you are doing, to continue being the example that you are for others. This wouldn't be possible if it wasn't for you. So have faith on yourself, because what you are doing is amazing. Again, people like ISOC that are very serious, you had a guy here that is the father of the internet praising about how good ISOC is bidding on you, is putting money on you for 2 years now. That means that what you are doing is pretty amazing, guys. So just believe in yourselves. To governments, again, to find ways of supporting self-provision, to development organizations to create national and international structures to support this movement, to the technical communities to keep on removing the barriers from creating technologies, to creating standards, to whatever it is that is needed for communities to engage in deploying their own networks, to research institutions, to keep generating evidence, to keep on making the point, and to private media to actually cover what you guys are doing, that is way more interesting than what big companies are doing. And finally, recommendation to all of you, thanks for being here, for showing interest on the topics and contributing to the establishment and the growth of the community networks movement in Africa. Thank you very much.